Hey folks, this is Brian. Short session tonight. And part of it had to do with conflicting interests within the character pool and concerns about where we are in the scenario and how do we go forward. So the party had divine intervention. Everybody shows up at the Isri's temple in Whitewall. The street guys there gather them all together and give them a room, do some healing, give them food and drink, and set them up to figure out what they're doing. And then they send off to the Runequest temple. These guys are back. They just showed up. Poof. So they had to do some kind of divine intervention. Things did not seem to go well for them. And if you want to watch the live play, it's in the description. Next day, Runequest Wind Lord shows up and says, "Hey guys, what happened? Looks like things didn't go too well. Tell me a story." So there's some discussion back and forth on things that did happen there. Even within from the players discussing things together on, hey, this, that, and the other. There were these spirits there, and we just can't deal with spirits. We need like a shaman to come out with us. And the only thing that goes, "Well, yeah, but a shaman is going to have to discorporate and do some kind of ritual in order to actually be able to fight with spirits. So, and we don't have any shamans here. But I can get some cult temple spirits that put them in a container that you can then use, and we'll give them instructions beforehand on what to do, and in which case you could use that to deal with these spirits." And they talked a bit about spirit temple spirits and stuff like that. And then Lars was thinking, that's right. These were temple spirits. They're probably tied to the temple itself and trying to figure out, okay, at what point would they be no longer in the temple and that kind of thing. And so there's some discussion on that and some sharing back and forth. And then they brought up all these concerns about, hey, these are in the troll woods here. And there was actually one night we were out in the woods and a troll army is a war band, but troll army came through, and the only reason they didn't kill us is because there was another troll army there. They ended up fighting, especially trollkins. They were out trying to find them and end up eating them. So while that was going on, the party, departed. And they ran into some interesting kind of things out there. You didn't mention the cave bear, Telmori kind of guy that they ran into out there. And then there was discussion about the brew. And so the party's thinking, if we can have some extra hands to provide a safe place for us to fall back to, a camp that can defend the camp against the brew and the trolls and whatever else that could be running around out there. That provides a safe haven to fall back to if we need to. That will work. Can you get us that? And obviously, as a GM, the last thing I want to do is just flush out the army with henchmen and hirelings and take, the play from them. In retrospect, there are a number of things that occurred that I probably should have adjusted for strength because of my conversion. And some things I did adjust for at the end. So, because I caught that. Because, okay, I need to adjust. This is too much. So I've got in my head things I'm going to do to adjust numbers-wise things that they're running into. I make some rolls, and he can give him an initiate, and he can probably get him, three or four, lay members, hireling kind of guys to go out and just defend the camp for these guys. He can probably do that. And then there was some discussion about, I'm a noble. I need to boost my oratory. Can I go and, do something to make some oratory to help flush out some guys and convince them to come help us? And so he went with the Wind Lord. They did the thing. He made his role. Good to go. And one of the players, his PC's concept did not fit with our situation at all. And part of that is my bust. I should have held a session zero with these three new guys. Hey, this is how I play. This is where we are in the scenario. This is stuff we did before. This is where I see things going. Because we did. We had like four sessions in a row where it was just combat, finishing combat, which I know for guys who aren't fighters is just part of that is RuneQuest. Strike rank versus strike rank. Shield absorbs. I mean, we were breaking shields and weapons left and right during the second combat down there, which really got me thinking about maybe I don't want to have this kind of what's the word? Cinema type play in my game. So that's something I'll discuss with the guys again later, and we'll see if we can't adjust the combat matrix to help cut that down some. But that's neither here nor there, really. So all these discussions about it, we need some port, and so then there was discussion about, can we do this? Do we think we can do this if we can get a safe haven plus, you know, these spirits that the Orlando Temple is going to loan to us? And that kind of thing. And the other player saying, you know, hey, this is not my guy's thing. I have no problem rolling up a new character, you know, an Orlanthe or Lankramai or something else that can tie in with the group better. I should have decision zero. So he's going to go and do that with one of the other players who's got a RQG bug. In fact, is recommended at the end of our discussion. Because after the play ends, we chatted just a handful of his players for, you know, another hour or so. Just about, not necessarily metagaming, but metagaming the game kind of thing on this is how stuff works and this, that, and the other, and lots of questions being asked and, you know, that kind of stuff going on. And it was brought up, you know, maybe you still want to hold the session zero with these guys to get them on the same playing field with what's been going on. And we'll do that. One of their players is going to do a meeting thing and connect with us when we get together next week. Have a little mini session zero and roll up his character and have that stuff go. Which in a way is better because that way I can be there for the character creation. I can educate them on my vision of the world. And how that will influence having character, cult, and occupation stuff. So it was all kind of just, okay, this is what we're going to do. The Orlanthe is going to get us this and this. And then we start looking at, well, we also are out of rune points. What can we do about that? And we are in Earth season. And it took me forever to find my calendar of where we were. Earth season, it's freeze day of movement week, and Geese's having a seasonal holy day coming up, but Beast of Gore can roll off of the Ernalda minor holy day on Clay Day, but that's about it till we get to the end of the month. Yeah, the end of the month where Lankramai gets their holy day. So we do a little, okay, let's do some worship stuff. If you want to make a check, an experience check on your worship skill roll, if it's at 90%, it's not stressful enough to read a check. You can augment your worship skill with sacrificing extra magic points. There's other things that you can do to give you modifiers. Because you still want to make that roll, because you want to be successful, so you can get your check mark, but it's got to be less than 90. You get, I think it's 10 points for magic point, but I'm just treating it like 5. You have plus 5 for every magic point above the 2 you need to spend, and you can't go negative. So we're trying to figure out you know, how many points could he get bonus wise, but you know, he's already got a 40%, so he needs, you know, 45 is, you know, actually 4.5 magic points extra to sacrifice, which is, you know, he can do that easy. And so they rolled against the 85, so they're two holy day getting their rune points back. The NGC guy, Noble, only had spent one rune point, so he got one rune point back. And then Arestra, the Beast of Gore, heavy infantry, made her roll, but she only rolled the one, so she only got one back. She could have got up to six, so it's kind of a bummer, because she's got some helpful rune magic, right? For combat. So, there's also, in the after part, there's some discussion about the NGC guys, rune magic has got, you know, summon water elemental and summon naiad, but they didn't really know what was going on. They didn't have the rules for all of what that really means. And so we had a little discussion about, you know, the small elemental takes, you know, 1 cubic meter of water. And there was a basin in one of the holy areas that was, you know, probably enough to make a small water elemental. And we discussed about a naiad needs to come from a natural body of water, a lake, a river. Probably not a stream. It's got to be deep enough for a person to be able to stand up out of, kind of thing. Maybe a pond, depending if it's magical or not. And then they start asking questions, well, what can she do? Well, she's got high intelligence, high power, high charisma, and she's got her charisma full of spirit magic points, and she's got a d20 worth of rune magic of, you know, earth or fertility spells, and powerhouse, if you can, you know, summon one up. And then there was some discussion on, well, is that something you do in combat? Well, obviously, you know, do in a combat, but at the end of the day, if your camp's near a river, summon one up, have her heal everybody. Massive, massive use of power that they could be very, very helpful in the long run. So there's some good educational comments going on. Another one of the players is kind of, well, he wants to play. Makes sense. Completely agree. But his character was not in positions where he could do the things that he's good at. You know, shooting his bow and doing other kinds of things like that. And so he's trying to do other stuff. So there's some discussion. Just because your guy's designed to do something right now, that's not really fitting in too well, because you know, these small hallways and caverns and stuff, doesn't mean he's a bad guy. You don't need to make a new guy. We just need to be able to pull out his skills for when they're, you know, applicable, because we all have to balance each other. He can use a spear. By all means, get a spear. And that way, hey, we're going down to the temple again. I'm bringing my spear. I'm not bothering with the bow. Good to go. No problem. Because he's really concerned, because his character has a low strength, and I should tell him. So I'm going to go ahead and give him, you know, 3 points of strength. And I'll talk about that in a second. No, I don't need to. If you look at the B team series of videos, I did a character creation follow-on, and it talks about the same sort of thing. Hey, you've been adventuring for 3 years. Technically, though, it's more like 5, because you're an adult at 16. Why are you waiting until you're 18 to actually go fight? So anyway, but 3 years, right? And so out of that 3 years, you get 3 points of power, because you get 3 rune points for 0 power cost. What about your other stats? Don't you get some stat increase rolls for those 3 years? Well, yeah, you should. And in the old RQ2, they actually had a chart rolled on. It was, you know, 25% or less on a D100. And you got either 1, 2, or 3, obviously. So like 3% chance of getting 3 points. But you roll that for every stat. Anyway, so I'm giving players, when they roll up 3 extra stat points, put them where you want. I'm not too worried about that. Still, you know, within limitations. You know, species limitations kind of thing. So I may just go ahead and give them 3 points. And go ahead and take 3. Just so you, because his strength is so low. And we discussed about some character creation stuff, because one of their players was going to get with the guy who's rolling up a new character was taking notes on, okay, this is what I allow on character creation, this, that, and the other kind of thing. And that's working out. Go ahead and take 3 points. excuse me. So, short session, it's just an hour, it's in the description. Pretty much just all conversation, role play, discussing things, figuring, you know, making plans. trying to get, you know, things set up, and then, you know, a couple of worship rolls, ceremonies. So it's going to be, I have to clear a day, Wednesday. It's going to be Wednesday of movement week, where the party's going to head back to the temple. It's a 2-day trip, if I remember right. Give me a chance to roll up some random encounter, possible random encounters. Plus there was something else I was thinking about I needed to do. Dealing with them moving out. Escapes me now. But we do some planning and preparation for the situation. There was also some discussion back and forth about, you know, where were the brew? Are the brew coordinating with the death cultists? And what else is going on down there? And, you know, the slaves and all that kind of stuff going on. And, you know, how many brew have we actually run into? Well, there was a spot where they had a whole bunch of brew. That's what they got now. But the brew guys attacking, you know, from the surface, it's just, you know, 4, I think, maybe 5 or 6 kind of thing. Now, admittedly, the guys who are defending the camp, they'll defend the camp, but if it gets to the point where they're going to run, they're going to run. But I'm kind of thinking maybe that camp needs to be outside the troll woods. So it'll be a trip to the safe place, but that keeps it out of the troll woods. Is there a chance for spillover? Yeah, there is, but it's not that significant. But we'll see how that all rolls out. So anyway, happy gaming.